things happening with Ag Technology. So we got 7 stores. Ag Technology is located at Rochester along with our home base store, which is New Holland, Rochester. So Ag Technology is a specialty company. That sprayer that's over here is supported out of Ag Technology. We do precision farming out of Ag Technology. So solar kind of fit that better than a full line dealership, maybe like Richmond. So we've had a dramatic increase of business in the last 12 months. I'll tell you very honestly, when I put my first 2 arrays up, got them going January 2012, I just wanted to see what they would do. I knew wind wasn't working, and solar prices were coming down. And solar surprised me how well it worked, as much as wind surprised me how well it didn't work. And then I figured out I could take some costs out of the stand and so on, and the prices kept coming down. So we got into the business. It was just going to be a sideline, just, you know, we'll take care of somebody who wants to buy one. And then things got better. We've grown that business every year. We actually did more business in solar, just in solar. We did more business in solar last year than any of our stores did total business except for the Rochester store. Think about that. Something that's off the wall, just for the 200s, whatever. We did that much business. That's how hot solar is. And people just don't, you read about that, how solar is doing gangbusters and all that sort of thing. When you really put the numbers together, there's a real opportunity there for everybody. There's more people employed in solar today than oil, coal, and gas combined. Blow your mind? Understand, though, that solar is in a build-up mode, where the other ones are a matured industry. So it does have, you got to think about that, too. But that's what's out there. So you hear about solar jobs, and that's a big deal. Last year, about this time, Kyocera, who was the only manufacturer we had got panels from, came and said, we are leaving the United States because of the foreign competition. We can't make any money here. They are still producing panels. They took it back to Asia and so forth. So we were scrambling and got lucky and partnered up with Solar World out of Hillsboro, Oregon. A very good move for us. Solar World was a company I would have gone with originally, but Kyocera was the only company that would sell me 48 panels. Everybody else said, go find a distributor. So, but we have a great relationship with Solar World, and really pleased to have their product. Enphase microinverters had a major upgrade, so I may as well pass that around. We're going to talk about microinverters a little bit later, but this is a microinverter. You want to take that and just pass around so people can kind of see. So we'll talk about that a little bit later. I'll just give you an opportunity to kind of understand how heavy that is and what it feels like. Solar cam, we upgraded, we're in the process of upgrading that for lower cost and faster install. We'll show you a little bit about that at the end. And we added a second full-time installer because we just got that busy. We couldn't keep up with one of them. This is what's behind everything. Everybody remember who Deep Throat was? Watergate scandal, remember that? What did he say? Follow the money. That's what's going on. Solar is cheap as coal. Germany, Australia, U.S., Spain, and Italy, and gaining every day. That's why everybody's excited about it. And of course, the Achilles heel of solar, just like wind, is that it can't be predicted. So we got a really nice sunny day out there today, yesterday. Was it rainy down here? Like it was? Not yet. That's what happened. So storage is going to be a big part of that. But right now, that's what's going on. And as long as solar is the cheapest form of energy over time, you're going to continue to see it grow. And I think we haven't seen anything yet. I think you're going to continue to see that price differential happen. So just got one slide here on how does solar work. So everybody is, you know, you've seen windmills, everybody has seen a gas or diesel power generator working and all that sort of thing. All of those devices have a lot of moving parts. Solar has 0 moving parts, nothing ever moves. So what really happens, so that's a generator right there leaning against the wall or against the post. And inside each of those cells, there are these front contacts right here. There is an N-type silicone product. Silicone is sand. Second most available element on Earth. There is plenty of it, okay? It's not quite the beach sand you're thinking about, but it's the same chemically, right, as beach sand. And then a P-type silicone here. P stands for phosphate, is what they lace that with. So without getting into the physics and the chemistry of it, I tell people, look, everybody has seen a popcorn popper work, right? You put the seeds in there, you turn it on the burner, we're putting energy into the popcorn seeds, and then what happens? They start flying around. They got all that energy in there, you got the gas expanded and it popped. That's what popcorn does. We're putting energy into the solar panel with sun. The photons of energy go through the front glass, go past the front contacts, into the both of these silicone materials, and because they're different chemically, the blue material down here, the P-type silicone, the electrons get excited, and just like the popcorn, it's flying all over the place. There's absolutely no rhyme or reason. It's not going to stay where it's at. Electrons do the same thing. Electrons are like a millionth the size of protons. So if we had a car hit another car, one was a million times heavier than the other, the little one moved, right? Well, you know what's moving here is the electrons. So the electrons get chased out of the blue material into the yellow material. That chases the protons down here. So now we have a potential difference. The wires are hooked up. We have a little lamp bulb here. That completes the circuit. It's just that simple. There is no moving parts. That panel and everyone on the market had a 25-year warranty. What else can you buy with a 25-year warranty? How about a 5-year? We have 5-year. I think we have extended warranty in the factory, not 5 years, but whatever. That's the basic advantage that solar has. There are no moving parts. We put some mechanical meters on some systems. That's the moving part, and that's it. So it's a very unique technology. It's been around for decades. It is as solid as gravity, and people that put the systems in should expect a 40-year life if the panel is a quality panel, but we'll talk about that a little bit later. So what makes SolarCam uniquely better? Well, we picked the name SolarCam, you'll see, because of the cam lock on the stand that we have patented. Obviously, solar is part of the deal, but it's more than just the cam lock. It's American-made solar panels, and from Solar World, I'm not saying we wouldn't ever go to another manufacturer if there was a good opportunity. As long as it was US-made, I'd consider it. It's an industry-leading Enphase microinverter from Enphase that's being passed around here. We'll talk about the microinverter a little bit later, but just so you know, that microinverter, wherever it's at, is getting me 9% more energy than a non-microinverter system. I have both of them side by side because the first two arrays I put in, just like Jill said, I mean, I want to know what the heck is going on, and microinverters are brand new. Even though it cost me a lot more money, I thought I'd get more energy, and it's going to take me 13 years to get that money back that I had to pay for that. Hey, it's part of your system, you know, that's okay. I still have, 27 years of free extra energy. So we have stuck with the microinverters for that reason, because we are interested in being very efficient. And in a commercial-grade solar stand that's locally made in Fulton County, Indiana by Craig Welding, it's our own design, and you'll see a little later where we are changing that design to make it even better. So everybody knows that the days are getting longer right now, aren't they? I think two nights ago, or Tuesday, it was sunny. I was up to like 7 o'clock, and it was still light. You know, that's what's happening. Anybody know when we're going to be halfway there to the longest day? What day of March? The 21st, spring solstice. We're going to be halfway there, and it just keeps getting better. Well, here's what's going on. That sun is moving from this degree down to this degree. It depends on where you're at in the world, where you start. But the difference is the same. It's 40 degrees. Everybody knows that 90 degrees is square, right? 45 is half of that, so 40 is pretty close. That's a lot. And if you think about it, Christmas time, high noon, sun, let's see which way is south. That's south. That sun just hanging out there over the horizon seems like. And in the summertime, it's up there, right? That's that 40 degrees. But there's nothing you're going to do about it, so we don't think about it. We just say, if that's the way it goes, days get longer, days get shorter. In solar, it's a big deal. And watch this. So this is a light shining on a little LED panel, and the LED light up above there, that's my son Mike, he's down here somewhere. He's going to turn that 20 degrees. There's some tape on the table that tells him where. So that's 20 degrees. And now he's going to go to 40. You see what happens? He's coming back to 20. Now watch the intensity of that light. Just watch. That's the difference. So if you have fixed tilt systems, they're rigid. At some point in time, they're going to be pretty good because they just happen to be at the right angle, right? But the rest of the year, as the sun moves, not so much. So you're going to see in a little bit how our stand works. For just a little bit of effort, you can pick up about 11% more energy. If you get, let's just say, 10% more energy in 1 year, think about this. Every 10 years, you get a free one. Okay? I don't know what y'all do for a living or anything like that, but let's just say that you were making, are you a farmer? Nope, you work for the paycheck. Okay, so if every 10 years your employer gave you a year salary, just for nothing, you would like that, wouldn't you? Okay, that's what we're doing. Think about it in those terms. Even 3%. On a 40-year deal, in 33 years, that's 1 3-year of energy, okay? All that little bit really makes a lot of difference. Yeah, this is the thing that people kind of understand, don't understand. So you folks aren't too far from Newcastle, and everybody maybe has seen that tilting system there. It's called the single axis tracker. Okay, so in the morning it faces east, most of the time it works, and it's facing west at night. But sometimes it doesn't work there. It kind of maintenance problem, but anybody ever will say that. So with our system and theirs and everybody else's, the sun's path means that perfect angle rarely happens. If it happens, like right now, 5 minutes from now, it's not going to be perfect. The sun's going to move, okay? Some trackers get very close, three-dimensional trackers, and they're almost dead now because they cost way too much and they're just too complex. So what we're shooting for is the best average angle. And here's what happens. So on the 21st of March, the sun is going to come up due east, right? That little black line right there, and it's going to set due west on that little black line right there. After that, it's going to start coming up north of due east, all the way to 13 degrees north. If you pay attention on June the 21st, and look what happens when the sun comes up, we've all seen it, but we never pay attention. It is really a lot further north than due east. I mean, it'll just surprise you. And it sets the same way. But look at the arc that the sun makes in the summertime versus the wintertime. So in the summer, the sun comes up. Here's the stationary solar system. It's actually shining on the backside. Of course, here it's on the building. It wouldn't matter any which way, but it's shining on the backside. So in the summertime, our solar panel, our solar ray is only 12 degrees off of horizontal. It's not flat, but it's pretty close. If the sun is going to get to the front side of that panel a lot sooner than if it's a fixed tilt system at 47 degrees, that's where most fixed tilt systems are at. And then as the sun gets higher in the day, because we're flat, we're going to have a better average angle. That's what you want to focus on. Same thing, of course, happens at night, or in the afternoon as the sun goes down. It sets behind the solar panels, sets behind ours too, but it stays on the front side longer. Okay? And you'll see in just a little bit how easy that was to do that. We really pick up a lot of benefit in the wintertime. You're going to see some pictures of snow here in a little bit, and Mike will pass some literature around there, some pictures of snow in there. So you see where the arc of the sun is at? That's why on Christmas Day, it seems like the sun is just hanging out there off the horizon. Well, we are a lot steeper, like 50 degrees off the horizontal, maybe 47, somewhere right in there. So the sun is actually at 37 degrees, okay? It's really low. But you can understand, because we're steeper, we pick up a lot more of that energy. Of course, there's less energy available. With December and January is like half of June and July. Okay, just keep that in your mind as well. So here's another video. Mike is going to change the angle from winter to spring. So he's loosening the cam lock. That's what we have the patent on. And that's something that I borrowed from the Underfoot head park, just so you know. It's not how smart you are, it's who you can copy your account. So he's got all three of them loosened up right now. And this is a trailer jack with a stainless steel cap over top of it. Stainless steel, obviously, so we don't have to paint it, and so it looks good. All that frame is galvanized. We say if you can take out the garbage, you can change your solar angle. It's that easy. So he's got to change, and now he's just locking the system back down. There's a timeline on here. 55 seconds is what that takes. Okay. So I've got two arrays out in my backyard at my home. They have four legs on them. We have two jacks. In that case, you pull the pin on one, you do what he did on the other, and then you adjust the jack and put the pin back in. It takes me about as long to walk out to the garden where the solar system is at and back as it does to adjust them. It's that easy. Okay. Anybody have any questions on that? Everybody understand?
Do you have them marked four times a year, like spring, summer, fall? Or?
Great question. Do we have them marked like that? No. The answer is no. We tried marking them, and it's kind of difficult to do. So we have three ways. We give you a decal so you know what day and how far to move it. We give you a length that the jack needs to be on there. Personally, I like to count the revolutions of the jack. And then the third way is an inclinometer, like a compass, if you will, but a magnetic device that you clamp on there, and then the needle moves as you change it. So a number of ways to do it. Great question, though. Anybody else? Everybody else understands that totally, right? If I had a solar right here, I could just actually go out and do that. So you saw it before, how much the sun moves and how important the solar angle is when you saw that light get dimmer and come back on. And you saw how it works, that it's not the perfect angle, it's the best average angle. This is how easy it is to do that. I actually have to give credit to a Purdue study that was done by a grad student. And he pretty much determined that if you were within 10 degrees of right, you were right. And then he figured out through the year, if you moved it to the optimal angle twice a year, or three times a year, or four times a year, all the way up to six. Well, once you got past four, your benefits started declining pretty fast. So that's why we focused on four. But people ask the question, can you change it every month? The answer is yes. You'll probably get tired of it because the benefit really isn't that much. But trust me, if you don't have it adjusted, you will see the difference. I mean, it's significant. So total of 11% through the year is what you're going to pick up if you adjust it versus a fixed tilt system. So that talks about our technology. There's a lot more to getting a good system, and it starts with a quality panel. So we have over here what's called a white on black panel for obvious reasons. This is also a Solar World panel they call all black. And some people for roof mounts think that this looks more attractive or looks less unattractive, if you want to say it that way, because some people in the suburbs, you know, they don't want your neighbor having solar panels on, but this is supposed to look better. And we have some people that like that better. They're both very efficient panels. This is 290 watts, this is 295, so, you know, basically the same output. And we only sell high-quality American-made solar panels there. Are more solar manufacturers out there. I think there's like 300 on the list. When we put these things in the computer and set your system up, we have to select which manufacturers. I mean, it's just a bunch of them. And they're just all over the place with quality and how long people in the manufacturer have been in business. So Kyocera, as well as Solar World, 40 years of manufacturing experience. There are a lot of solar companies out there with less than 10 years of experience offering 25-year warranties. How does that work? They haven't done it. A lot of them have an insurance policy to back that up, which is fine. But it's a whole lot better to know that you got the experience behind the solar panel. Okay, so we will stick with people that have experience that back their product up. Like I said, we've had a great relationship with Kyocera. We now have a great relationship with Solar World. They like us because we do a lot of business with them. But you start with a high quality panel. So this is what's in the Solar World panel in best-in-class light capture technology. So this is that silicone material with the N and the P-type materials in it. You see this yellow bar here? They call that a metal contact grid line. So you see that solar panel over there? There's five small wires going vertically in each cell, right? Those are called bus bars. What you can't see from here is what that gold bar is, which is the crosswires. They are only about a 16th of an inch apart. They are so small that they are put on with a printer. So Mike and his brother Eric, who's not here, they work in solar with me, but we were out there in Hillsboro and we saw this material that's a paste. I mean, it's almost like mayonnaise, and it's put on with a printer. They print that wire. That's how thin it is. If that wire breaks, so if you have two pieces of wire and it broke, but you touch them together, they're going to transfer electricity, right? But there's a resistance in that point, and it's called a hotspot. Still works. May work just as well as if it's actually connected, but sooner or later, probably sooner, that's going to cause trouble. Well, now the current can go another way, because all those cross wires going this way are connected to the ones going vertically, okay? Solar World has five bus bars. A lot of technology out there is only three. You're going to see in just a little bit how that is all put together. But as long as you got more bus bars, there's more paths for the electricity to go to. And as long as you have a good glass and a good back panel, you're going to have less flexing, because it got pretty cold this winter, didn't it? It's going to get pretty hot this summer. That all works on those wires. Sooner or later, Solar World included, there's going to be hot spots. And we don't really care about how many hotspots there are, because we monitor every single panel for energy output, which is what we're really interested in. If the panel fails, we need to have some proof, and we'll get into that in just a little bit. So PERC Technologies, and I had to put up here what it stands for because I always forget. But basically, you wouldn't believe it, but light shining on that solar panel, some photons get through. So they have a special material on the backside, that rear contact, that chases those photons back, reflects them back into the solar cell. It's 3% more energy. SolarWorld was the first major manufacturer to adopt that technology. That's why I mentioned the 3% just a little bit ago. Think about that. Just because of that rear contact, 33 years to get a free one. That's what that does. Driving down the road or just walking by that solar panel, you have no idea, and neither do I, what's in that cell, but that's what you're getting if you buy a quality solar panel. And quality is no accident, so the materials that you build the tractor out of or car or whatever, I mean, if you got poor glass and a windshield, something like that is probably going to crack faster than a good quality glass. So International Electro something Commission is what that IEC stands for, but that's the blue book, if you will, on materials. So three times the standard is what the stuff has to meet before SolarWorld is going to use it. And all those little wires I told you about, who would have guessed there were 2,016 soldering points in each one of those panels? How many of you have ever used a soldering gun? How many of you have ever failed to make a good soldering joint? There we go. It's not fun, is it? Darn stuff won't stick, but when it works, it's pretty nice. It flows right in. So SolarWorld has, I mean, the whole process, to be honest with you, I mean, it was just impressive. It's automated. So fully automated for every one of the 2016 soldering points. Hate to say it, but the machine is probably going to be a little more consistent. You know, they're not tired and they don't have an aching joint, whatever. And if there's a problem, you're going to know about it. But it dramatically limits the short and long term. If you don't have a good joint, you're going to have a lot more hot spots. So we will always look for a quality solar panel. This is the main reason. There's a patriotic mission, but so I was up against a competitor on a deal in Trenton, Illinois, competitor out of St. Louis, and this is the JA Solar. So I'm reading up on it. I hadn't really heard much about them or anything, and I'm reading the warranty, and you can't read it, and I left it small on purpose because you want to read the fine print. This says that if you have a JA Solar panel that you think you have warranty coming on, you get to arrange shipping over the Pacific Ocean back to China. They will then look at it and decide whether it's warrantable. They will also decide whether they're going to pay you for your shipping costs. $200 panel. How many here want to ship a panel over the Pacific Ocean for $200? Not me. What does that do to your warranty? It ain't there, okay? We want to be the dealer, so if you have a panel from us, regardless of what circumstances are, you think you got a problem, you can come to us and we'll take care of it. Good news is, we never have replaced the Kyocera panel, not one. We've only been doing SolarWorld since about June of last year, so we don't even have a year in, so that's kind of a short time, but we haven't replaced one of them either. If it's not damaging shipment, we had one or two of those from time to time, but I'm telling you, once we put it on the stand, it stays there. So I would rather have that than a good warranty anyway. This is buy stuff that works and be done with it, but you get a range of freight and you get to decide if they're going to reimburse you not only for the panel, but also for the freight. Are there any questions on solar panels? There's a lot of different technologies out there, thin film, polysilicone, monosilicone. Monosilicone is the highest quality, that's all we sell. Okay. Any questions? Everybody understand how that works? So I didn't put it in the slide presentation, but those hot spots I was telling you about, the way you tell if you have hot spots, if you don't have the recording that the microinverter is going to give you, I'll show you in a minute. You fly over with a drone with an infrared camera and it finds the hot spots. You then give it to the owner and say, okay, you got however many panels with however many hot spots, whatever it might be. Now you go out there and watch those panels, see if they're producing like they're supposed to produce. Who wants to do that? That's a lot easier way, and here's how you do that. So the inverter is often overlooked. Everybody talks about the solar panels and whether they're all black, whether they're white on black, and all that sort of thing. Well, the inverter is every bit as important as the solar panel itself. So Enphase invented the microinverters, and what a microinverter means is every one of those solar panels has one of those microinverters, wherever it's at. One for one, It's a lot different than a string inverter where you have one bigger inverter that services multiple panels. And we've documented 8.96% more energy on a string inverter, and that's over 5 years now. And we'll keep monitoring that, but I think the message is pretty clear. There's a reason for that, extra energy. So on the left in this example, you see this panel that's mostly covered with something, and it is making 90 watts of power. These other two are in the same string. They are also making 90 watts of power, but they are not covered with anything. You all have seen the old Christmas tree lights, unscrew one bulb, whole string goes out, right? Same deal here. So even without some shading, I mean, no bird crap on it, no leaves, no whatever, some panels are not as good as others. In a string system, your best panel is your worst panel. That's what I've got on that string inverter system. There's two strings of 12, is what I've got on the 24 panel array. Right? On the other one with the microinverter, we have this situation. Here's a covered up panel. Of course, it's 90 watts, just like this covered up panel. But because this is a parallel circuit, each one of these is on its own. Apparently, this is a 215 watt panel. So this making full power. It's not impacted by the other panel. Where that really comes into play in our world around here is snow, which we got more of it in Rochester than you guys have down here in Richmond. Frost, which we may have about the same amount of, I don't know. And then there's always some shading from, you know, some dust and then panel inefficiency and all that sort of thing. So with a microinverter system, that goes away. Okay? So that extra energy that I'm getting is going to take me 13 years to recoup my expense. This is why. There is a side benefit. So if we have two wires, a positive and negative wire that plugs into that microinverter and then out comes the alternating current, we're making AC current. Same stuff that's lighting these light bulbs, same stuff that would run your TV. We're making it right at the panel. With every single string inverter, you have direct current. Looks like I need some direct current in my light. There it goes. So this is a picture, of course, it's on tin roof, and of course this happens to be from Australia where it gets pretty hot any which way, and you see what happens. So most string inverters have direct current up to 1,000 volts DC. So that truck, and well, that might be a 24-volt tractor over there. So tractor cars at 12 volts. Have you ever taken a set of jumper cables and accidentally touched the two ends together? Anybody done that? Sparks, right? 12 volts. What do you think 1,000 volts does? And now they're going to 1,500 volts. And all that's fine if the installation is done, is good, and then everything is done right, you know, it's all tested, certified to work. But what happens when the installation gets bad? What happens if somebody accidentally, you know, scrapes it or animal chews on a little bit and gets rid of some of that? You now have the ability to have an arc, and this is what can happen. On a ground mount system, it may not burn, but the back on a solar panel can burn. So we only go to 37 volts. That's the maximum you can get on that solar panel with that microinverter. Think about that, 37 instead of 1,000. Your chances of an arc event are just fractional. It's a lot easier on a panel too because we're not sending high voltage through. In every string inverter, that voltage goes from one panel to the next one in the string to the next one because it's a series circuit. So by having a lower voltage, if you have a hot spot, anyway, near hot, at 37 volts as it will at 1,000 or 1,500. So rapid shutdown and smart inverter ratings are important. These are two National Energy Code criteria that were put into place January 1st of this year. I think only Massachusetts and California and Hawaii in our union adopted it day one. We'll get there in Indiana in about 4 years. I don't know that in a ground mount system, the rapid shutdown is that big. What really happened is up on roof mounts, think about this. Is anybody here on the fire department? Anybody? No firemen? I don't see a fire. That's a good thing because we have any firemen in the house apparently. But the firemen up there, if they got to chop a hole in the roof, think about that. Put a hole in there. You got a lot of voltage. It's connected to other panels. You would like that thing to shut down. So rapid shutdown means 5 milliseconds, that thing has to be dead. The microinverter makes that happen. The smart inverter is a little bit different deal. If the sun comes across the sky and here's the cloud comes and knocks that sunlight down, voltage changes a lot, cloud leaves, goes the other direction. The utilities don't like that. They're trying to control the voltage and it's just like that, especially on a bigger system. So the smart inverter if something is an inverter, that utility can control it. So if the voltage gets too high, they can immediately shut it down, I mean, with the speed of light. And conversely, if it's too low, they can actually step the voltage up in a microinverter. It shuts the current down, but steps the voltage up. It's the same amount of power, but that's all you're going to get. So that's how that works. So that's called a smart inverter. If you put a solar system in Hawaii or California, it has to be a smart inverter. That's going to come here to sunny Indiana one of these days, okay? What I'm more worried about is those that are not rapid shutdown, and the insurance company sees that, especially if it's a school or, you know, someplace where kids are around, they're going to say that's a higher risk, and they're right. I don't know that how real that risk is, but it is another risk, and of course that's what they're all about. We are already there. If you do a microinverter system, and you can buy an Enphase microinverter from, I mean, the internet, whatever is out there, not something we have any control over. We just want to do the best job we can do. So if you buy the solar camp system, you're getting a microinverter. This is why there was no question about what I was going to do with the microinverter, string inverter. This is a picture of the Farm Service Agency, the FSA office, and my battery is going down. So this is an office building that I have up in Rochester, and there's 64 panels here, two different arrays. Those numbers on there is the power that each of those panels has made that day. I could go online on this computer, I'm online right now, I can go on the system, and I can tell you what each one of these panels was doing in 2012 in August when we put this thing into motion. What time of the day it was doing it. I can tell you what the Duke Energy voltage was. I can tell you what every single panel DC voltage was. As a dealer, my dad was a farm equipment dealer, grew up in Southern Illinois. If you don't have service after the sale, you're out of business. No different with solar, okay? We can monitor each one of these from we can do it on the phone, actually. Wherever we can get on the internet, you as the owner can do the same thing. If you can't measure it, you can't manage it. So we can measure it sitting there at the computer. If I want to know what's going on, this is right across the driveway from the store. If I want to know what's going on there, I go to my computer. I don't walk across the driveway because I can tell a whole lot more here than I ever could if I go out there with the voltmeter. You understand how important that is? A lot of owners like to see what's going on, and I mean, that's how you do it. It's just that simple. Any questions on how that is? So whenever I talk to school people and talk to hog farmers or whatever, and say, you know, do you manage the progress of the student? Do you manage the health of the hogs or whatever? Oh, sure we do. Well, why do you do that? Well, it's just good business. So why would you put a solar system up without being able to measure the health, the activity, the production of each panel? That's why, okay? And that's automatically there with the solar panel. So people ask the question, how much does that server cost? And the answer is nothing. At least up to this point in time, it comes with the deal for us, and we pass it on to the customer. So you have 24/7 monitoring and no annual fee, okay? If you don't have a microinverter, that doesn't happen. So we talked about storage. Does anybody recognize that name there, Tesla? I think I asked that a while ago. I think that's the front end of a Tesla car there. This is a Powerwall 2 battery. So we talked about 14 years ago. Who would have thought that we would have the ability to buy a battery that would run your house and you can go to Home Depot and get it? Because about 3 weeks ago, Tesla announced that they will put their products in on a kiosk, a counter, if you will, with their employees in 800 Home Depots across North America. Battery storage is that common now. Okay, they haven't got it there yet, but I'm thinking like the third quarter of this year, you'll be able. So where's the nearest Home Depot around here?
Greenfield.
So that's what, 25, 30 miles? So you can drive 25 or 30 miles away and bring home a battery that will run your house. If that happened in about, what, 4 years since Tesla first came out with the Powerwall 1, think of what's going to happen in 14 years. Okay, that's how fast things are changing. So a lot of people ask us about storage, and right now I'm here to tell you that from a pure monetary standpoint, storage doesn't pay, even with the utility policies from OEMC, but that's going to change and it's going to happen this year, well, whenever the Powerwall 2 comes out. because I'm here to tell you, so we have a house, it's about $200 a month that we pay an electricity bill. If I didn't have solar, and it's an electric house, okay, I would have to buy three of those power walls and a 20 kilowatt generator. I can go off grid, I can have my money back in about 12 years. I won't be paying the $29 fee that they charge me every month just to hook up. And of course, I won't pay for the electricity, but that's how close that is. We have a very, my home's on RMC in Fulton County. They have a good policy. So I'm not gonna do it probably for that reason, but I did it just to learn. So here's the deal. These two boxes are batteries. You might be able to see the green light right there. That tells me that the thing is charged. If it's blinking green, it's charging. If it's solid green, it's fully charged. If it's solid blue, it's fully discharged. If it's blinking blue, it's discharging. It's powering my house. So I've come to learn, we just did this a couple weeks ago because I wanted to get ready for the meetings, and we finally were able to get the product. But it'll run my house. These two little batteries will run my house for about 2 hours, 2.5 hours in the evening. So it's just me and the wife, a couple lights on TV, and that's probably about it. So it's just as simple. You see this little conduit with wire to the breaker box? This is the monitor down here that used to be in my garage in the house. This is an unattached garage. There's a meter, mechanical meter here that just tells me what the solar system does. So it's just that clean. I can add more batteries underneath here. Part of the reason I put it where I put it, a power wall will fit there, okay? So one of these days, it's probably gonna happen. But it's just that simple. There are no moving parts. And it's really cool. So I was out there working last Sunday on this tractor I'm restoring. Had a few clouds, had some pretty good sun. So a cloud comes across and blocks the sun. The light went from charging green to discharging blue. It started, instead of taking in the energy, it turned around and started putting out energy. The cloud went away and back to the green lights. No switches, no nothing. It just happened like automatically, okay? If I don't do anything else today, if I can convince each of you without ever trying to sell you anything, because I would sell you battery right now because I don't have a good deal for you. But if you leave here comfortable with the idea that storage is going to be part of your life and mine very soon, this was worth it. Because that is going to happen. There'd have to be no question about it. General Motors says that by 2023, they will have 20 models of cars that are either pure battery, hybrid, or fuel cell. 2023, 5 years from now, that's going to happen. Anybody here got an electric car? You got an electric car?
Hybrid.
A hybrid? You like it? So far. So far. you're thinking there's disappointment coming your way. So, I think in most cases, I haven't really heard of anybody unhappy with the electric car. The Tesla owners, they're passionate. I mean, they are disciples of Elon Musk. And the cars are very good. I mean, if you're getting drive right one, you'll see why. But battery storage is what's coming. So this is what happened at my house on one of the screens. So this was the third day I had it. You see it's been through three charge cycles. It tells me that my battery is 29% charged. And this is each battery on this page here. So this is one battery taking in 277 watts. That's as fast as it'll charge, okay? So the other battery would have given me the exact same information. But this is the really cool screen right here. So the dark orange is when I'm taking the energy from the utility. So that's nighttime, okay? Blue is when the solar system is charging the battery, powering the house, putting stuff on the grid. So you see this green down here is the state of charge of the battery. So right here where I got the line where I checked the time, it had just got fully charged. So it's still putting just a real little bit of power in the battery, 48 watts at this particular moment. This is a 15-second interval, incidentally. So 2,969 watts went to the grid, went to the RDMC. I'll get it back at 80%. They docked me 20%. And this is the total solar production. It should be the sum of these two numbers. Okay, so you can look at the one screen and you can see what's going on with your entire system. So as the day went on, the sun started going down, solar production started going down. I'm keeping sending it to the grid because my battery is fully charged. Gets here to nighttime when the sun goes down, and look what happens to the battery. It starts discharging. And in about 3 hours, I'm totally running on the grid again. But you see how little energy we actually take from the utility while the battery is discharging. And then that looks like about time everybody goes to bed. So we don't use much tonight. That's how that works. No moving parts. Any questions? So anybody know what the battery technology is that's making all of this happen? What kind of batteries do those parts use? Lithium. And there's a couple kinds of lithium. Lithium ferrous, which is what I've got, does not need a cooling device. Lithium cobalt does. If you get cobalt on fire, you will not put it out. Anybody remember the Dreamliner, the 787 Boeing jetliner that had that fiber material? Had lithium cobalt batteries in, they got hot. Up there in the airplane is not the place to have a fire. It's just not going to work, okay? So that's one of the downfalls of the lithium cobalt, but it is the least expensive way to make a battery right now, a lithium battery. And that's what they're using in the Tesla cars. So this is the next step, because there's not that much lithium around. So this is a power source, and I'll turn it on right now. So this is the negative anode. So this is negative DC power right here. And we'll go back, and I think the numbers were jumping around, I was adjusting them. So the left is the current, the right is the voltage. And you see how much hydrogen we're making? This is the oxygen. Anybody know why there's half as much oxygen as hydrogen? Somebody knows that. It's what? H2O, that's right, twice as much hydrogen as oxygen. So what I really want to show you, right now I'm running 1 amp of current, okay? And I'm running exactly 6 volts of power, okay? So that's, you multiply 2, that's 6 watts, okay? Each one of those light bulbs up there is taking 13 watts. Not the picture, there's 4, is there 4? That's a different kind of bulb. So on a 4-bulb LED light fixture, the 4-foot bulb is taking about 13 watts. This is half of that, just half of one bulb. And you see how much hydrogen we're making? So the problem with the lithium battery is that it uses lithium, which is not nearly as available as silicone or hydrogen. Hydrogen is the most available element on Earth. There's not that much of it around. So what are you going to do if you have like a grain farm? Or irrigation use, whatever, what, 2 months we irrigate, 2 months we dry the grain, whatever, the other 10 months we're making energy, we got to store that. It would take a huge battery just for a small farm to do that. Think of what a foundry would use. We have a foundry in Rochester that's all electric. It would take 80 acres of solar panels in order to make the energy that that foundry uses. How are we going to store that? And that's just one foundry in Little Rochester, Indiana. The answer is hydrogen. Have you heard the term hydrogen economy? Anybody? Well, that's what they talk about, what's coming. And the problem with that is, if you make hydrogen and then you run the hydrogen, you capture the oxygen, you capture the hydrogen, and then you run that through a fuel cell, you reverse the situation. So instead of making the two gases with electricity, the two gases turn to water and make electricity, we only get about 55% of the energy back that we put in. So we're losing a lot, right? Anybody know how much energy you use in one of the most efficient internal combustion engines on the market? Anybody know? We have some pretty efficient engines. The Fiat powertrain engines we use are pretty efficient. There's other, you know, Deutz makes a very good engine. 75% we lose. Okay? So you would think that losing maybe 45% is not that bad of a deal, right? But it just hasn't happened yet. But what's happened now is solar has become efficient enough and cheap enough that we can afford to lose that kind of energy. The reason we can lose 75% in an internal combustion engine and nobody cares is the fuel that we are using is cheap enough and is dense enough. If you carry a 5-gallon bucket of diesel fuel around, I don't know what the BTUs or kilowatts of energy that's available in it, but it's a bunch. That's the problem with every other kind of form of energy, your transport energy, you're fighting that density because you can put it in the tank and go quite a ways. So with electric car, they talk about the range. That's a big deal. How much can you store in a battery? So this is what's coming. And just like the lithium-ion and lithium-ferrous batteries, It isn't that far away. The pieces of the puzzle are in place. There's a company in Redmond, Washington. Anybody know what else is in Redmond, Washington besides an energy company? Anybody heard of Microsoft? Well, might be another startup company there, but they said that they have got this down to 80% efficient, only losing 20%. You compare that up with a fuel cell that's about 50%, now we're up to a total of maybe 65 or 70%. That works. I mean, that works right now. So all we have to do is have a hydrogen tank that we can store the hydrogen in. So for the irrigation guy, or the, you know, that's an extreme example. Most of our homes are much more steady use. Livestock farms are just beautiful. They use a lot of energy in the summer when solar's good, and not so much in the winter when solar's not as strong, but so different applications. But I just wanted to, you know, we don't sell this stuff and all that sort of thing. I just wanted to share with you what's coming. And solar is where it all starts. We do sell that. And you can put it on your house, pair up with the utility, and you'll do something right now. Battery storage is right around the corner. You can say it's here, but it's here, economically feasible in maybe yet this year. And hydrogen, probably 4 or 5 years, that'll start to happen. Okay, any questions? Understand all that? And there's no moving parts, and this, you know, that's a big deal with me. Of course, you know, we got to fix a lot of stuff that breaks, and that's the way machinery is. But so solar is a no moving parts thing, but so is the hydrogen economy. Of course, we have a DC power supply, which would be a solar panel or a windmill. You just have the two anodes, negative and positive, making the hydrogen. You store, there's no moving parts. Anybody want to guess how you compress hydrogen without any moving parts? Anybody know? So this glass jar has a sealed lid on it. I did that so I don't spill the water. Which incidentally, that's not just water. That's water with an electrolyte in it so that the current can flow. That sounds pretty high tech, right? Has anybody heard of Drano? Drano, that's what's in, that's the electrolyte. But if I say Drano, you say, well, that's not very big. That's not a big deal, right? Electrolyte sounds a lot sexier. Anyway. So that's all you got to do, but if you want to capture that and compress it, you just capture the hydrogen and don't let it get out any other place, and you can go up to thousands of pounds of pressure and only lose 3% efficiency. That's a whole lot better than a pump, because hydrogen would be, any gas would be hard to pump. So the piece of the puzzle are there, and 4 or 5 years from now when you actually can buy a hydrogen storage system, remember me, because that's that close. And just by way of example that, you know, this is not as far-fetched, even though it's not the battery, close to the battery technology. This is a hydrogen power tractor that New Holland has on test for about 6 years now on an energy sustainable farm in Italy. So what's in here is hydrogen storage, the fuel cell, the electric motors, actuators that do stuff, okay? Incidentally, at that same farm was developed a tractor that will be on the market next year that runs on methane. So dairy farms or the livestock farms that have digesters that have methane will be able to buy a tractor and use the gas they're producing on the farm. It also runs on LP gas. That was necessary so there's enough market out there. But it was introduced at the Farm Progress Show last fall, or last August. We're that close. So back to reality. So the other part of the solar system that you want to pay attention to is what everybody calls the racking. Because we only do ground mounts, we call it a solar stand, but you want to look for strength and quality in the stand, 40-year journey. And there's some junk out there. I have a system on a hog farm in Paulding, Ohio, and one of the best compliments that somebody can get is the farmer had another farmer they're looking at. He was interested in solar. He looked at the stand and he said, that's commercial grade. He had been looking at solar systems and the stands he'd seen weren't anywhere as strong as that. So, you know, we built the thing to be strong, and but we know it's got to last a long time. But get your 40 pipe going across there, the A-frame legs with concrete in the ground, and we are changing that. There's the microinverter bolted on right behind. It's a very simple system, as you saw in that video where Mike was changing the angle. This is what you want to avoid. So it was the same deal as I was telling you about with that J Solar warranty thing I showed you earlier, the Trenton, Illinois deal. On the competitive website is this picture. And I looked at that and said, there is something not right about this. So I zeroed in on this joint right here. This is an earth pier, which is what we are going to. And I zeroed in and look what's there. See that? You think that'll hold up to 90 mile an hour wind? 5,300 pounds of force is what that joint has to hold in a 90 mile an hour wind. Then there's not a chance. So I don't have a slide on what we're doing, but it's a whole lot better than that, I can tell you that. But you got to watch for that sort of stuff. If you go to the solar system in Frankton, Indiana, you got to look through the chain link fence, like 1-inch pipes, just like stilts. They will rust through before 40 years is out, and that system will be down. Nothing against roof mounts. We don't do them, but roof mounts penetrate the roof. The roof is there to keep the rain out. Some people don't have any choice, so that's just the way it goes. But with the ground mount, we have the opportunity to change the angle. But this looks like a nice roof-mounted system. This is the Newcastle system. And a couple years ago, Joel, wherever Joel was at, and I were at a meeting in Newcastle. 6 o'clock in the evening, we drove by, and I dropped him off at the restaurant. I turned around, said, I got to take a picture. And this car buzzed by me just as I was doing that. But it was 6 in the evening. These panels are facing east. These panels think it's high noon. I think there might have been a few pointing west like there was supposed to. Everything, I mean, we have a service department for a reason, so I'm not going to take a shot at these folks here. But with our system, you saw how easy it was to turn the jack. I mean, it's not going to break down. This is not going to happen. But I'm going to show you what happens with efficiency in just a little bit. So keep that picture in mind. So this is a fixed tilt system up in Wauwatosa, Indiana, so on Highway 30, Kankakee Valley REMC. That's our system right there. This REMC bought two systems, one from us and one from a competitor in Minnesota who went broke last year and went out of business, but it snowed on Wednesday. This is Saturday. See all that snow? This is a string inverter system. They lost 4 days of production because if you block one panel, you just knock the rest of them out because it's a string inverter. See where the snow is at on our system? By the grace of God, we're steeper in the wintertime. If it's 10 degrees Fahrenheit or higher with this kind of sun in winter, the snow's going to slide off. I'm not sure when that came off between Wednesday and Saturday, but obviously everything is on the ground. That's why I say the truth of the matter is with our angle winter is a bigger percentage difference than summer is. So follow the money. I said earlier, and here's the deal. This is 2016, first 10 months, beginning of the year to November the 3rd. First three systems are ours. Kankakee Valley is the one you just saw with the snow. Phil Overdorf at the chicken farmer in Tipton County. Dave Smith is a grain farmer in Rochester. Since Kankakee Valley was the best one, we call that 100%. Phil Overmeyer's wire to the chicken house is a little bit smaller than it should be. There's some resistance there. It cost him a few percentage of efficiency. Dave Smith at 99% is basically as good as Kankakee Valley. The next three systems are Indiana Municipal Power Association systems. They're much larger, but you can manage the efficiency by measuring the kilowatt hours per kilowatt. It's like comparing the fuel mileage of a semi to a Volkswagen. 17% for Crawfordville, less efficient. 24% for Frankton, and Peru is 22% less efficient. Here's the Newcastle system you just saw. Tilted. 93% of the efficiency of Kankakee Valley, and Kankakee Valley is in a higher snow belt than Newcastle ever thought about being. I thought when I saw these single axle tractors come along, if we could just be close, I'd be happy, because they're more expensive and they're a heck of a lot more maintenance prone. But we're actually more efficient without all those moving parts. So update that for 2017. Phil Overdorf's internet was down when I did this, so I didn't get him. Kankakee Valley is again at 100%. Dave Smith is 98 instead of 99%, but probably snow or something made the difference. IMPA took theirs off of the internet. They no longer show what their efficiency is. They are going to the active trackers like Newcastle has. That's the buzz in the utility scale solar business. They don't want to go out there and move the arrays like Mike did in that one slide I showed you there. Here's the Newcastle system. It's better last year than the year before, but still 3% less efficient than the solar camp system. And I forgot to tell you on the last slide, but this one up here is of particular interest to me. Mill Creek Elementary is a school in LaPorte County. It's about 12 miles as a crow flies from Kankakee Valley. Last year, they had about 30% less energy than the salesman that sold it to him said they were going to get. And in 10 months, they had 1,027 kilowatt hours per kilowatt. They only got a little bit more last year, but it's 12 months, not 10 months. That system has a real problem, hot spots or something, and they don't know it. Because they don't have the monitoring system that you would get with a microinverter system. That's what goes on in our business. So we were talking to somebody earlier from Jay County, the camera people right there. There's a solar system not being used up there, right? There are windmills around that we've helped people with. There are solar systems like that we've helped people with. I'm telling you, if the salesman trying to sell you something, can't take you to a system doing what he or she said it's supposed to do, you run. Because there is no standard, there's no accountability in this industry. With tractors, we have the Nebraska test. So let's say your tractor, the Nebraska test says 200 horsepower, but you don't have it. I'm liable because you have something to back that up. Solar business, nothing. Windmills, nothing. Biomass, nothing, okay? So make the other salesman, make whoever show you that they're the system doing what we say it'll do. And if you can't, go someplace else. This is a cash flow worksheet, and I only have it up here to show you the tool that we use to show you how solar will or won't pay back for you. Everybody's situation here is different because you've got different utilities and different needs, size and so forth. But we put the parameters in on the left side here, the total installed cost, size of the system, energy it's going to produce. This person has 9.5 cent energy, and then the spreadsheet calculates the total cash flow way over on the right side there. And in this case, the person is borrowing the money. So these are 10 years of payments. But you see over on the right side, the person is always cash flow positive. This assumes that the person can use the 30% tax credit for the down payment. Not everybody has that kind of appetite. And we'll make this work for you. You tell us what to put in there, and we'll let it calculate. It's just a tool, okay? But we want to show you the real facts. I can't tell you how many county departments have looked at this spreadsheet, and it survives all the time. It's just simple calculation. You can make it say whatever you want it to say. So we let the customer tell us what to put in for parameters so it fits your exact need. Okay? So if you're interested in knowing what it might or might not do for you, this is a key tool to make that happen. So we are interested in doing things right. We are at the highest level of rating with Enphase, a premium installer, a Better Business Bureau rating. The Solar World Authorized Dealer that's the emblem there, but we are at their highest level of install. If you go on the Solar World site and look for a dealer in this part of the world, we're there. So not satisfied with good, we want to be better. So 2 weekends ago, took this picture. That's our store in Rochester with the blue roof behind it. So those are earth piers. I showed you that picture a little bit ago, said you don't want to do this because that bracket's not very strong. So there's a round disc on top of this earth pier. We have a bracket that we've designed that's going to lock that leg on there. And if the pier is not lined up with the leg exactly, the bracket will compensate for that. It will be just as strong if it's off a little bit than if it's not. But we're going to be within an inch left or right, or an inch 4.5. We are going to put it in that right. So we put those piers down in the ground. We did testing 2 weekends ago and again last weekend, and just this morning right here from Jeff's office, I got the word from the engineer that it's going to be certified because we applied 3 times the force that a 90 mile an hour wind is going to apply to those legs. It only moved those piers 3/8 of an inch, and they moved back 1/4 of an inch. That 1/8 is probably just play in the bracket or something. It's that good. I was shocked, to be honest with you. That's a 6-foot pier down in the ground. It was a lot wetter last weekend than when this picture was taken the weekend before. But this is going to be faster. It's going to be simpler. But the big thing is, I don't know where each of you would put a solar system if everybody here said, I'm going to do a solar system. But I can tell you that your ground is going to be different than his ground, different than your ground. And that makes a difference on how much tension and compression that lake is going to stand. With an earth pier, when you put that in the ground like we're doing right here, this machine won't do it, but they have machines, the drivers, that will measure the torque going in the ground, you multiply the torque times 10, you have the compression and tension force. So we're doing soil analysis when we're putting that pier in the ground. And I'll be able to hand the customer the data that it'll print off with the USB stick. Here's your record. So you can take it to the insurance company. You can, for your own peace of mind, for my own peace of mind, we know that that thing is right. If I got to put it in a sand pile, we just got to deal with that Stella College up in Plymouth, or Donaldson by Plymouth this week. It is going into a sand pile. It's a glacial pile of sand. And if we don't get the torque that we need, we'll go deeper or bigger. We'll just unscrew the one that didn't work and put something deeper. That's what we'll be able to do. So that was a major goal of mine. Like I say, faster, less expensive, and better. That's what we're after.
Are you doing that today? I mean, you know, I'm planning on getting a panel put up next week.
You'll have to wait a little bit.
Or a month, whenever you can.
What is your, what's your soil type?
I'm not positive.
Where'd you go back? Is it clay?
It will be clay. I mean.
Yeah, you'll be all right.
At some point, yeah.
Yeah. We know that we have over 5,300 pounds is what we have to have for tension. Our skid loader will pick up just like 5,100 pounds. So there, and we put there's a separate anchor goes in there. So as long as you're clay, you're going to be fine. And if you want to wait, I'm fine with that. But we literally made the decision yesterday anticipating the certification, but I was at the manufacturer yesterday afternoon and decided we're going to go with the new leg with the earth pier for anything we build going forward. So we're just going to use up the inventory that we got. And the same top part, the pipe and the outrigger, will still be the same for the time being. We're working on a change there too, but that's a little less. I'm not as close, okay? So yeah, whatever you'd like to do, I'm going to make sure you're happy with what you get. But great question. So anybody else got a question? Well, here's a question that you should ask yourself. Because it is just that simple. So right now, those of you who are farmers know that milk prices, farm prices, bean prices are not as good as we'd like them to be, okay? So what happens is, somebody would like to have that new tractor there, but the checking account's not quite where it should be. You just use the old tractor for a while, right? Well, with solar, it works a little differently. That cash flow worksheet will show you that you will spend the same money in taxes and electricity bills as the system costs. So where do you want to be in 7, 8, 9, 10 years? That's where the payoff, that's where it pays off generally. Where do you want to be? You want to have a solar system that's still got another 30 or so years of life of free energy? Or do you want to have the receipts from the utility company and your IRS form that shows you paid more taxes than you should have? That's what happens. And I tell people, I don't want to be quite so blunt, but that's the reality of the situation, okay? So you don't have to buy solar. You can buy a windmill. You can just keep doing what you're going to be just fine. But from a monetary standpoint, solar is that good a deal. In fact, we almost hesitate offering that advice because, okay, if it's that good a deal, why hasn't everybody done it? And the answer is too many people have had a windmill that didn't stay working, they haven't had a solar system that kept in play, or whatever that happens, and you hear about that stuff. And it gives you a lot of apprehension. Plus, there's just a lot of people that just don't understand. I mean, that's why we do these kind of clinics. We want to show you what's going on, okay? So we just try to give you some creative information, and you can decide what to do from there. So that's my presentation.